bit of a progress with graphics. So experimenting with basic extreme learning machine, I noticed that the prediction diverges. So the neural network learns very well the data that we feed it, but the prediction then we get a large spread, so it can go very high, very low, so it didn't really learn the function as well as we wanted. I wanted to plot this opening spread, this mo, so to speak. The mo that happens when we didn't learn very well. And I like how in this paper they have this area. This area which shows very well this divergence, which is also known as dispersion, variability, scatter, spread. And Dark Eclipse experimented with drawing this spread with e-charts. I can show it because he didn't publish his notebook. But it seems that e-charts, drawing this spread isn't something supported out of the box. At least we didn't find it. And this reminds me that my preferable way of drawing charts is by working with pixels, setting pixels. This is portable because when you set pixels, you can then display them in any device. And you can do all kind of stuff that you cannot really do with out-of-the-box charts. We looked into e-charts originally because it allowed for three-dimensional charts, which I thought would be harder to implement with just the pixels. It turns out that ArrayPy, which I use from Rust in order to accelerate the neural network computations in order to perform them on the specialized graphical processing unit. Turns out that ArrayPy offers also plotting facilities and 3D plotting in particular. So, for example, we can run ArrayPy example, which we can see that it has no problem with drawing 3D graphics, with plotting in 3D. And I did some experiments from Rust to confirm this. And given that we can draw 3D graphics from array charts, it means that we can also draw two-dimensional graphics as well. And it is more convenient because we can do this directly from the Rust program that works with the neural networks. So it samples the network and draws the graphic immediately from the same code. There is no need to export the data, import it, and to work across languages. But in order to work with pixels, I had to do some research because there wasn't a good example of how to work with pixels in ArrayChart. And in order to draw some advanced graphics, like the graphic of a scatter, we needed to work with pixels. So to understand how to work with pixels, I have looked at image IOCPP, which is an implementation in ArrayFire of reading a picture into the ArrayFire array which resides in the graphical processing unit memory. So from a read image, we see that the array first it is allocated in CPU memory and split into several regions. And these regions are colors, so red, green, blue color, and the channel for pictures which has a channel. And then this loop shows us. So basically, they fill these regions fill them pixel by pixel. Loop shows us that we iterate on X first, and then on which is important because when this isn't documented anywhere, we have to glean this order, how the pixels are laid out in the array. We have to glean this from source code. And then in each of these regions, we simply set the value to the respective color, so red, green, and blue. And we define the dimensions of this array as height, width, and the number of colors. We copy the data then from CPU to GPU. So this is the same code in Rust created from this example, which draws on the pixel array. So we allocate a pixel array, which is the size of it is width by height, so all the pixels, and all the pixels three times, because we have the sections for red, green, and blue. This separation into sections is simply adding the size of the screen So we have in this array, we have three screens. Just the red screen, the green screen, and blue screen. And we add the size of the screen in pixels to get to the green screen and then to the blue screen. Usually when I test how the pixel array maps to the picture that we can see, I usually assign the colors based on the pixel position. So here X grows, red grows from left to right, green grows I suppose from top to bottom, and we should check this, by the way. So green goes from top to bottom. The more we go down, the more we have the green. Top down. And red goes from left to right. So very, very natural. So with this, I can verify that we have mapped the pixels of the array, the layout of the array is correct. You might not notice that the color changes, changes slightly, because there is this animation that shifts the blue from zero to the full blue and back. So initially the blue is zero. Here we see the dimensions, height, width, and three colors, just as in the C++. So blue is initially zero. And then instead of recreating this array for the animation, I decided to try to modify this array of pixels in the GPU, in the graphical processing unit. So I told the ArrayFire to slice this three-dimensional array. So we get any x, any y, and we get only blue. So we get some strange multidimensional slice, which only focus on the blue color of this multidimensional array. And then we assign to the slice an array that has this shifting blue color. So this slicing, to see how it's done in C++ code, we can look at the image demo C++. In C++, it's just RGB span span O, RGB span span 1. So apparently, it is a function operator which produces this kind of slice. In Rust, the syntax is there are macros, but if you avoid the macros, show sugar, then the syntax is more verbose for the slicing. But it is essentially this line here is similar to this line. And then the blue color is calculated from the frame count. To implement animation, ArrayFire simply wants us to call the draw image and show from the loop. So we simply have a loop in the program and keep putting elements in that loop. What's interesting is that we can move the element, in this case the image, we can move it. We are still placing the image in the loop and it still changes, but it's position, the user shifts the position of the image and it's kind of independent. This user adjustment is independent from our own actions to display the image. So behind this scenes, ArrayFire tracks this image to how it was adjusted. And I guess it's adjustment per cell, because they have so this is a grid, it can be split into cells. So this is one cell, there might be more cells, and I guess the cell is adjusted independently. Okay, so let me show this adjustment. Here we can move the surface. So they have a cell, and in this cell we can move the content that is generated by the program. So I thought this code and this display of colors, this animated shifted display of colors, I saw it pretty, even though it isn't of immediate usability, I'll scrap it, but I think it would be interesting to show how it works while it's here. And by the way, this works on Windows, but from a Linux program, because I didn't want to install Visual Studio. I didn't like that in order to work with CUDA, the Visual Studio is required. So instead, I've used the Windows subsystem for Linux, which supports working with CUDA, with the graphical processing unit from Linux. But I had to upgrade to Windows 11 for that, because Windows 10 doesn't have the necessary drivers. And by the way, it's hard to find information. Took me a while to find it, but you can check whether this works by going into Visual Subsystem for Linux and looking for dev.dxg. If we have dev.dxg device, then Windows provided the access to the graphical processing unit to the Linux, and the Linux can then use it. And on Windows 10, this file would be missing, but on Windows 11, when everything else is in place, this file appears and everything starts to work. And also, for Windows 11, I need it to be part of Insider program, which I was already the Windows Insider. But I still couldn't upgrade to Windows 11 because it was telling me that hardware doesn't match the criteria. And it turns out we can check using this third-party project, why not Win 11, we can check what's missing in the hardware. So in my case, what's missing was the TPM version. And it was a mystery because I had to press a secret combination of keys. Right shift, right control, left alt and F2. Secret combination of keys in the BIOS to show hidden configuration items. And then I could enable the security device support in the BIOS. And I guess it was turned off because there is no security device. It says no security device. But what's interesting is that Windows does not require Windows 11 doesn't require the device itself. It just needs this flip in BIOS to support security device. So once I flipped it on, this entry became green, and I could switch to the beta channel, upgrade to Windows 11, and then Windows Subsystem for Linux began to see the graphical processing unit, which allows me to draw these graphics. So we have a Linux program which uses graphical processing unit using the Linux drivers and draws the graphics using the Linux X11. And it all works without Visual Studio code. Sorry, without Visual Studio, without the usual CUDA environment that is required for Linux. So the next step is probably to make the actual graphics that would show the spread, the dispersion that appears on the borders of a neural network prediction on the data on which we haven't trained the network yet. And then I'm going to try different options using a genetic algorithm, try different network configurations. I would try using a smaller number of neurons, try different activation functions and some such. And ideally, I would see how spread changes depending on the different options. I'm not quite sure how to implement it yet because we have these many dimensions. Every option is a separate dimension, and we can animate the change in one dimension. For example, the change we can show how spread changes with the number of neurons. But how do we explore many dimensions of options? It's an interesting change. But even if you show these graphics at random, it already helps us with identifying some interesting cases. And then looking closer at these cases by animating across a single dimension, across a single option. As usual, if you'd like to help and experiment with neural networks in Rust and R5 and with drawing graphics of that, then drop me a note. There are bounties for the work as quantified by the videos, showing something interesting like this one.